Our first guest this morning joined Bain & Company back in 1988, and in 2017, he was promoted to Worldwide Managing Director. Now, Bain & Company is one of the big three in the global consulting firms. Here to weigh in on some of the main themes facing the world and the Philippines, especially investors, and how businesses can more wisely position, Manny Maceda, Worldwide Managing Partner at Bain & Company, joins us live. Hi, Manny. Good morning. Hi.
Hi, Mimi. So happy to be here. Thanks for having me.
All right. So let's start with a big picture. I mean, there's so much going on these days. Inflation, of course, is a paramount problem, forcing central banks to turn aggressive, risking recovery from the pandemic. Very interesting times we're living in, to say the least. How is it affecting your clients? I mean, can you give us a sense as to just how worried they seem to be at this point, and what are the major issues picking industries?
You know, I would say our clients are both corporations as well as financial investors, private equity firms, you know, view this as a real time of uncertainty. And it's not just the inflation that you raised. You start with the bigger picture of multi-year trends that are going on. We've been going through a digital transformation for a few years. That has benefits, that has investment costs. We've been going through an ESG, a sustainability agenda that requires transition. And, you know, as we sit here in the middle of 2022, for parts of the world, including here, we're still dealing with the impact of COVID. So on top of all those forces that are changing businesses and how you invest and where you invest, you add on inflation and obviously some of the root causes of that, a war going on in Europe that are changing energy and food prices, the challenges in China affecting global supply chains. And so you have an inflationary environment, and as you saw from Chairman Powell, interest rates is one of the levers that governments can use to try to manage inflation, also add to the equation. So you have this this perfect storm of all these forces affecting what we'd hoped for would be a robust global economy until COVID hit and then was recovering and then the war hit. So it's a lot of uncertainty, and people are bracing for what are the changes, how do we invest, how do we manage in this period, and you know it could be an uncertain period for quarters, if not years, to come.
Mm-hmm. Uncertainty period for quarters to come. I know that you do consultancy at Bain & Company for pretty much everything, from supply chains to talent management, private equity, procurement, sales and marketing, sustainability, and as you mentioned, digital transformation. From your vantage point, are you expecting activities to slow down given all of these uncertainties?
The business activity on all those fronts are quite robust, Mimi, and so the answer is it depends on which ones. Most companies still have to achieve their long-term agenda, transforming, growing, while dealing with the short-term realities. Well, how do you do that in an uncertain environment, perhaps with inflation? And, you know, we have management teams that haven't dealt with this level of inflation or even an interest rate environment in many years. So rather than slow down necessarily is the way you think about it, I'd say all of these investors and companies are really trying to build resilience and adaptability and anticipate flexible strategies that you adjust. Because it's very hard to predict, frankly, when trends might stop. Some would argue they're going to keep coming at us.
Let's look at the Philippines in particular. You know, the Philippines is still a reopening play. We're at the cusp of a leadership change, economically speaking. How does the country, the Philippines, and its economy stack up against regional peers, you think?
Well, you know, the Philippines actually, we're finally seeing this country come out of COVID. And unfortunately, we've had this issue. It's obviously a country that's dependent on outside sources of energy and oil, and in some cases even food. So, but it is has great fundamentals as a nation with a great domestic market, some source of competitive advantage, especially in people. And then if you look at what's going on globally, as countries are rebalancing, as companies and investors are rebalancing their investment portfolios, whether your corporation is choosing where to invest, in your factories or your call centers or your centers of excellence, or financial investors looking to what to put money in foreign direct investment, whether it's in private equity. For those who are all of those global investors, many of them are clients, are rebalancing and thinking, where should we be? And obviously one of the core issues for those who want to stay in Asia is, well, how much exposure should we have in China, which for many years had been the biggest place you invest as a global company in Asia. As we've watched in the last few months, when the world almost instantaneously pulled out of Russia, and while people are not pulling out of China, even starting from the Trump administration 6 years ago to now continued with Biden, deglobalizing a bit and reducing your dependency on China is a macro force that's making companies look at, well, if you want to stay in Asia, we want to have a supply chain that's not more dependent in China, where should we go? And so the ASEAN market broadly is one that absolutely we see as could be a winner in this. And I think it's very important that the Philippines amongst the ASEAN countries is one that that takes our share of global investment that gets redirected in a post-China-centric world.
So what do you tell your Philippine clients? How do they succeed in a world like this?
You know, it's because of uncertainty, long-term, what I call long-term linear multi-year planning strategy is very complicated and perhaps not the right way to approach it. You start with what you can do long-term is be very clear about the mission, the purpose, you know, what does the company stand for, whether you're a corporate or investor. And then select strategies to achieve that purpose and mission, which could be what products, what markets, what customer segments, you know, what countries, because Philippine companies are not just operating the Philippines. Many of our clients here are actually going out into the region as well. You have to do that with a sort of an agile, adaptive, resilient approach. It's strategy that you can move quickly, because the reality is that none of us can predict how soon, you know, we will get out of this next crisis. You can't sit here and say, we've had some people assert COVID was a black swan event. Well, what if it's not? What if there is a series of these kinds of endemics? We could have some people say Russia invading Ukraine and the implication on global markets was a black swan event. Mm-hmm. But what if that? So you just have to have strategies that are designed to withstand all of these shocks, surprises. And so the way you do that is you be faster, you be agile, you spread your bets. You know, most companies have a core business that you want to keep investing in strong, but you have to always build new ones. And it's clearly a more complicated world at the moment, but it's one where I think the clients with the right mindsets will step up and survive and thrive.
I know that you mostly talk to private companies, corporations, and investors, but for a second here, why don't we look at the Philippines as the country, as the biggest Philippine corporation? It's the Philippines Inc. We have a new CEO coming in, President-elect Ferdinand Marcos Jr. How would you advise Philippines Inc. to create a winning culture, to be run as a global organization, playing with the big boys in the big league? What would your advice be to the next administration?
Well, you know, it's companies are not countries are not companies, Mimi. I understand that. Mm-hmm. So it's an analogy and a metaphor that you can only stretch so far. Mm-hmm. I would say if you think of this as organizations, the mission and purpose of countries, you know, to be successful, the clarity of what that is, right? Can you say in the world, if you look at the world, does Singapore stand for something in the business community, you know, or the United States or Russia? So you could say, if you're the Philippines, what is that? What does the Philippines stand for? You know, what can we build on that? And that's why they say, if you're a company, you say, what's the mission and purpose? And I think that's a very important thing to try to define, you know. And then if you do have that, the capabilities that enhance that, that allow you to be better, you know, to attract business better or to compete better for the companies that make up your country, in this case, you know, Filipino companies, I think that's where we need to get very sharp. Obviously, one one obvious source of potential competitive advantage we would have as a country, in my opinion, is our talent. You know, and so and talent in the Philippines, I'd like us to expand. This is a country that's always been a massive source of talent exported in some, you know, in nurses, etc. But in terms of talent actually applied to good management, good leadership, good business building, and where folks like my generation and others have been successful in global companies or in companies here, that's one of the things I would call out that I'd like us to figure out how to make that a real source of comparative advantage in the region and in the world. And if we do that, you know, then perhaps we can bring an economic success in country too.
So talent management, that would be key. Interesting to note, the vice president herself is going to be leading the education sector. So that sector is going to get a lot of attention. What about agriculture? I'm just very curious. What do you think about the agriculture sector in the Philippines? I mean, you've got the president taking over the agricultural portfolio. It's a very rare occurrence that you've got a president being a secretary of a certain portfolio. So agriculture, what are your thoughts on that?
You know, I'm not an expert on public sector agriculture. Mm-hmm. I would say if I look at the challenges in the world, back to all of these macro forces I talked about earlier, you know, including energy, so absolutely food in all its forms. So I'll broaden it. Agriculture, obviously, as the core source of food, is one of those most important things companies and countries and regions and the world, frankly, has to get right. And there's so much going on in that sector. There's the near-term issues of kinks in the supply because of what's happening in Ukraine globally, but new technologies to make agriculture more sustainable, to actually have it be healthier. You know, all of those are quite critical. So I would definitely call out that if you were to pick what are some of the sectors that you have to get right, absolutely, that's absolutely one of them.
All right. And final question, Manny, from the other side, from the private side, how should the private sector engage? You know, you've got businesses, they don't operate in a vacuum. Businesses operate within an environment that is actually set up by government. So how do you think can the private sector, can private businesses better engage with government? Less friction, more collaboration.
You know, this is an interesting time in the world. If I look at the global sustainability agenda and what we need to address, the old model of pure private sector competitive capitalism against each other, which is what, you know, many business students learn growing up, it's going to be challenged for the private sector to work. We are learning, and I see this in organizations like, you know, the World Economic Forum or the Business Roundtable in the United States. I'm sure that's happening here in Chambers of Commerce. We have to work with the government. We have to work not just with our government, but with other governments, because if business models and economies, even in a less globalized world, is not defined just by the boundaries of your company and not by the boundaries of your country. So we have to work with governments, we have to work with other governments, and often we have to work with each other. If I go back to the theme in sustainability, and what I'm seeing is, you know, when companies work together, that's how you often get better design product, you know, less waste, more circularity. So I do think collaboration is important. It's not a natural act for some companies, and it sometimes will arguably slow things down. But definitely to solve the big problems in the world in the long term. I know we're focused on near-term inflation concerns, you know, but we do have a long-term survival of our planet at stake, and I absolutely think more collaboration is required to succeed.
All right. And on that note, thank you very much, Manny, for your insights this morning and for joining us. Do keep safe, and we'll look forward to our next conversation. Thank you.
Thanks, Mimi.